Hello everybody out there in the YouTube community, and welcome back to another episode of Anime Weekly with myself and Jeremy.
What's up, guys?
Jeremy on one side of me. I don't know where they put him. They put him somewhere. It's here. Here. So, we had our first episode. We had a blast. This episode, we got a lot of animes to talk about. We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We've got a new anime to add to the list. And we have a preview to one you guys are going to be seeing next week. I believe that's the 10th. Yep. That'll be the 10th. 3, 6, 9, 10. Yeah, that will be the 10th one for the show. And I will go down the list of things. Now, guys, you know we are behind on a lot of the series. As I'm going down the list, I'm going to make mention we did jump ahead on a few. One, which was towards the end, we actually binged the entire series too. And one we're going to be completely jumping to the recent episode next week.
So. Oh yeah, and also really quick, thanks a lot for your great feedback, guys.
Oh, we love.
We were looking at the comments. You guys are awesome. We're glad you enjoyed the show, even though we're still trying to find our footing. I'm glad you enjoyed it. It was a fun episode.
Oh, Jeremy, do you want to talk about what we're going to be doing next weekend? Because next weekend there's going to be another Anime Weekly, but before Anime Weekly episode 3, there will be
The Otaku Hour Episode 1, which is it's basically this, but super condensed into an hour live show where we talk about everything we've watched over the month and a more in-depth talk. Because, with the weekly stuff, we kind of just do it bit by bit because it's only episode by episode. But now we can talk in chunks about things, and we can since we're going to actually do it as a live show instead of pre-recorded, we'll get to have a Q&A session with you guys. You guys can talk about stuff with us, and we're even thinking about possibly doing a viewer pick section for the following month's episode. We'll talk about an anime you guys suggest.
Mm-hmm. But nothing in the 90s until after we do the 90s special. So
yep, and for the 90s special, we're nothing set in stone yet, but we are debating on getting a guest for that one, mm-hmm. who depending on how things go, may or may not be a recurring guest on the show.
Right. So, yes.
Definitely looking forward to that one.
So I'm just going to check the program, and the program's running good. I'm sorry. I noticed towards the end of the recording, so I apologize in advance if this happens. I became a little choppy again. It could have been because of the storm that was coming, because the storm was coming, I believe, when we recorded last. No, the storm hit this weekend. There was something, and that could have been why it was choppy. I think there was maybe rain or something.
It was definitely raining. I'm pretty sure it was raining.
Okay, that could be why then. So hopefully this time the recording's a lot better. I should have done a test. Next time I'll remember to do a test 2-minute one, but let's keep our fingers crossed that everything goes well. So now the rundown for this week, the things we're going to be talking about, and I will be timestamping them again. So I hope that helps some of you guys out. Let me know in the comments if it does. The shows we will be talking about and episodes are, we're going to be talking about Dragon Ball Super episode 28. Finally, we are away from the movies.
New content stuff. Yay. I'm so excited.
We got One Piece, 727. Fairy Tales, 93 is all Jeremy again because I completely forgot. I thought I watched everything, and Fairy Tales, I forgot to put it on my watch list, and that's what happens when you don't do that. Send that to me also, by the way, Jeremy,
yep,
so I won't
no
forget.
No problem.
We got Naruto Shippuden, episode 445, still in filler mode, of course. Luck and Logic, which is a newcomer, episode 1 through 3, the first 3 episodes. Man, I can't wait till we get to that.
Yeah, this is a brand new one that we checked, was on our radar, but we didn't know when it was going to start. And a bunch of anime just randomly started out of nowhere, and they're all up to 3 episodes now. And one of them I'll also talk about later. But we're really excited to talk about this one, and hopefully you guys will check it out too, because it's a great series.
Absolutely. Okay, here's one that we finally decided to forget about going through the old episodes, which I did. Jeremy didn't, so Jeremy's going to be doing it this week alone. Gundam Iron-Blooded Orphans, episode 14. Jeremy made the full jump all the way to the end. We decided to go with that. I'll give my thoughts on the series. I did watch a little bit further on. He got maybe...
And I think it might be even further than 14. I just think the furthest I jumped to was 14. I think it might be up to 16 now, but that's only a couple episodes. That's only a couple episodes to watch. So
I'll do a check while while we're talking about it. But I watched, I think I reviewed up to episode 5. So I watched a couple episodes after that. So Jeremy kind of got like maybe, I would say, about 6 episodes ahead of me.
Yeah, so we kind of did another even distribution. You've got half of it, and I've got half of it, so we can kind of do that.
Mm-hmm. And Mobile Suit Gundam Iron-Blooded Orphans is at episode 16, so let me correct myself in saying it's episode 16, not 14. If you see the description below, you'll know that it's episode 16 and not 14 and that I'm a complete idiot. So going back to the list, we have Garo, Season 2, Episode 2, which both of us watched this time. And the good news is next week we are going to be jumping all the way into the future to the current episode of Garo, Season 2. We're going to skip the whole middle part, or we'll binge the whole middle part and get our way to the latest episode.
And if anything, we'll wiki it. And if we're missing anything, you guys feel free to just tell us what we missed in the comments.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. If we missed anything ever in any anime, do not hesitate to correct us or fill us in on what we didn't put out or what we weren't sure about.
Just don't be a dick about it. That's rule number one.
That's rule number one. Pokemon XYZ episodes 2 through 9. We go from the second episode all the way to the most recent episode. It'll be an overview all the way until we get to episode 9, by the way, because we are not going to discuss a lot of, like, 8 episodes worth of one show.
Yeah.
Assassination Classroom, we did the latest 2, which is episode 2 and 3, so we're officially caught up.
Yeah, and we covered episode 1 last week, so that pretty much is, you know, we did that in nice order.
Exactly. And we are going to be giving, or Jeremy actually is going to be giving an overview of Dimension W. That was a series we both wanted to do. We didn't know it came out. Jeremy actually watched the first 3 episodes already. I didn't know, so I'm going to watch it after this show, and we're going to do episode 1 through 4 next week. But Jeremy's going to give us a little bit of a preview of what the series is about, and then, of course, we'll close out the show.
Yeah, and hopefully, you know, like, I can pitch it so you guys will, you know, check it out, because I think this is another good one. Like, this is a good year for sci-fi, for anime, from what we've been looking at.
Mm. So, all right, let's not waste any time, and let's... Excuse me a second. If we're going to do this, we're going to do this right! Okay, let's get into it.
All right.
Okay. Dragon Ball Super episode... Whoop, let me get the timer here. Dragon Ball Super episode number 78. 45. Wow. It took
28. 48. No, I'm talking about the episode. You said 78.
That's a time.
Oh, my bad.
Timing, man. Episode 28. So we are officially away from the movies now. Vegeta and Goku are now training with Beerus and
Whis.
But Beerus is basically sleeping. Whis is the one that's training Goku and Vegeta. We get introduced to a new character, and I thought of Jeremy right away because he mentioned that the creator made all of the characters named after liquor. Mm-hmm. So we get introduced to Champa.
Yep.
Named after champagne.
And then Vottles, who's named after vodka. It's pretty funny. Like, Toriyama loves his puns, and one thing that I also really liked is that, like, in the beginning, it shows, like, the progression of Vegeta and Goku's friendship. They're no longer rivals. They're like they're like training buddies now. They're encouraging each other. Like, come on, one more, man, one more. You got this. It was cool. And they had these like weird fat suits, and like Vegeta was talking about how like this was even more intense than the gravity chamber. I'm like, oh man.
I felt like I was in a Twilight Zone when it came to Vegeta. He was so, obviously it's character development. In GT, he was the same way, kind of. He was a little bit more still into himself, but I guess this was a proper progression.
Although in GT, you gotta admit, he had an awesome mustache. I think he had
an awesome. I was glad he shaved that off, though, I will say that.
Yeah. But anyway, yeah, it is some good character progression for Vegeta. Like, mm-hmm. He's really nice now, and I it's kind of, it's weird. Like, it's weird to adjust to, but I also really like it.
I like it, and the same thing. I felt like I'm looking, I'm like, is that Vegeta, or did they, like, like lobotomize him and bring him back or something. What?
No, like is he high? Like he seems a little mellow.
So they're training and they're in these fat suits the whole time. My one problem with this episode was it was too comedic, but it was a setup. It was a very good setup.
Yeah, and I mean, it's definitely, but it's not like overly comedic. No. It was a Dragon Ball type comedic, which I missed that kind of thing. So I was like, I'm cool with this.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely! I love this episode. I really like that, and you mentioned they were going to do this. They're going into how there are 12 different universe, like different dimensions, mm-hmm. and there's an Earth in all 12 dimensions, and Champa is basically what Beerus is in Goku and Vegeta's universe, which their universe is universe number 7, I believe.
Yeah, Goku, our universe is universe 7, and then Champa's universe is universe 6. Mm-hmm. So just to put it in perspective for, like, comic fans, like, think of Goku and Vegeta's Earth as, like, Earth Prime, and
right.
then you've got Champa and Vadel's Earth as Earth 2. In a way, even though...
No, that's right. Oh, then you
yep, okay, so, good. No, yeah, so that's how that works. And, you know, we got a staple of the Dragon Ball Z universe established again. We're having another Budokai, and I'm so excited.
I'm really happy. I liked it, and the one thing I really liked was the fight between Beerus and Champa. At first, was all about food. He brings him these eggs from his universe or his place.
Yeah, he's trying to one up Beerus. Like my world has better food than yours. And then I love that the food Beerus brings out to trump everybody is cup ramen.
I wanted to bring it on the show. Oh, I'm so stupid. I should have thrown it. Oh.
And it was awesome. Like, because when Vados and Champa try it for the first time, they're like, oh.
Where do we
get this? What is this?
And then he says Earth, and it turns out in Champa's universe, I hope I'm saying his name right, and I'm not butchering it, his Earth was destroyed by war. So
yeah, it looks like that whole planet got, like, nuked. Like, it looked pretty rough.
It could have been I'll die if they ever make, like, in one universe, Frieza one. In another universe, Cell one. In another universe, Majin Buu one.
From what I understand, from what I've glimpsed of, like, the manga, apparently, in this universe, well, I don't know about Earth. I know Earth was destroyed because of a war or whatever, like I said in the episode. But from what I understand, in this universe, the Saiyans never went to planet Vegeta. They stayed on their home planet. And they're actually good guys in the universe 6.
In Champa's, you know.
Okay. Yeah. They're actually good guys. They're, like, instead of conquering planets, they actually are, like, kind of like Green Lanterns. They, like, rescue planets and stuff.
Oh, that's awesome. See, that would have been cool for the Saiyans to do.
Yeah, so that's going to be cool. And, this is kind of a spoiler, but I don't know if they're going to follow the manga exactly, because, you know, they're always kind of, like, you know, iffy on it. But from what I've seen, they're going to have a setup for Champa's team, and there is going to be a Saiyan on there. And I'm not entirely sure if this Saiyan is a female or a male, because he looks like a young boy, but it could be, like, a tomboyish girl. And they never say him or her. And you never know with anime.
Because,
I mean, look at Nagisa from Assassination Classroom. For the longest time, I thought he was a girl.
I showed Cindy, and she thought it was a girl, too.
Yep. See? So, yeah, I really hope it's a female Saiyan, because I think that would be awesome. Like, because you know how, like, there's, like, Whis is a dude, and you've got his twin sister, Vados. What if on this universe 7, that's Vegeta's, like, twin sister? Because they look, because they're both short.
I'm like, that I looks know. Like, I don't know. Looks,
I'll show you. I'll show you afterwards. But yeah, they're both short. So I think she could be Vegeta's twin if it's a girl. It might be a dude. I don't know. But it's a cool setup for the tournament. Like, I like seeing Beerus and Champa fight. And I also like the difference in Beerus and Champa's personalities. Beerus is, like, very strict and very tough. And Champa, like, he was just walking for a little bit, and he just...
yeah.
And he has, like, a soda addiction or something. Like, he has, like, this big gulp of soda. And he's always drinking down. I thought that was hilarious.
Well, let's talk about what the tournament's about. The tournament is Champa wants Beerus's Earth, our Earth, Prime Earth, and then if he wins, that's what he wants. He wants to do a flip-flop. So the dead Earth will go into the original, the regular, the universe that we've been in, and the living Earth will move into Champa's universe. Yep. And if Beerus's team wins, and it's going to be a tournament, and it's going to be, I think it's going to be like the
other. It's, yeah, it's 5v5. It's 5v5. So top five fighters of each universe.
Mm-hmm.
We already know two spots are being taken by Goku and Vegeta.
And Goku's the one that encouraged Beerus to say yes. I'm like, Goku, are you stupid? Really?
He just wants a challenge. You gotta admire that spirit, man. And Vegeta's, I love Vegeta's reaction. He's just like, okay, I guess. Yeah. I mean, I want to train, but I guess this is a good way for me to test myself, so I guess it'll work.
Mm.
He's like, I'm cool either way.
But I thought of what me and you were saying when Champa loses, Beerus gets Dragon Balls. But they're not Namek-sized Dragon Balls. They are planet-sized Dragon Balls.
Exactly. I was dying laughing because we had that whole conversation about what if they made replicas of the Namekian Dragon Balls instead of the regular-sized Dragon Balls. They would
be carrying these big-ass balls.
Big-ass, like, basketball-sized Dragon Balls. But could you imagine if they made replicas of those? Like, they would be they'd be like the size of a fucking chandelier. Like,
more. These are planets. You're talking about the ones from Namek, not the ones that are from Champa's universe.
Yeah, no, but I mean, obviously they can't do it to scale planet-wise. But I'm saying, like, if they do like a replica version of the Champa ones, it'd be like as big as a chandelier.
At least, or you'd have to make it as big as a house.
Yep. Oh man, like that would probably be on display somewhere in Japan.
Oh, like, that would be so cool. But I enjoyed the episode. I don't know. I felt like, I guess because I haven't watched Dragon Ball as a TV series, not that it felt weird.
Yeah, it's been several years since you've actually gotten like the serial next time on Dragon Ball Z moment, and
exactly.
this was more of a setup. So I can see that. I was definitely generally more excited because I'm like, finally, it's not a movie. I can finally watch this again.
Yeah, but movies, when it came to the movies, it didn't feel like it was so canon because the movies were one and done. We're done, you know.
Yeah, but you know what I mean. Like the movie thing, it was just seriously just a rehash with like lower quality animation. So why am I even watching this in the first place? Mm-hmm. But now we're in newer content, so I'm really excited for this. Like, so who do you think is gonna end up being on Goku's team? We got two, right? We have two spots already filled with Goku and Vegeta. And then I know Beerus apparently is going to – next episode, because we saw in the preview, next episode we're going to see Beerus summons a fighter from their universe who is even more powerful than Goku. So there's a third guy that we don't know.
I don't think anybody else from Earth is going to be in it unless they pick Gohan, because Gohan
– They've got to use Gohan. They got to redeem Gohan again, because Gohan already said he was starting to train more. And it seems like it's been some time. It looked like there was a time skip, because their clothes look different.
Yeah, it could be. I don't know. See, that's the thing. We don't know if there was really a huge time skip or if they've – I didn't see the last episode of – you know, they ended the movie.
Yeah, they ended it with Gohan saying, Piccolo, I want you to train me again. Right. And then it seems like some time has passed, so it might be a few months tops. So maybe Gohan's back into the swing of things, and so he'll start. Because obviously they're going to have, like with every tournament, they have a period of a few months of training before the actual tournament starts. So I'm sure Goku and Vegeta will help Gohan get back into shape. And
that would be interesting.
I just really want Gohan to be legit again, and maybe go Super Saiyan Blue, because
that would
be so
cool.
That would be awesome.
I'm eager to see where this goes. I'm happy that we're getting new Dragon Ball Z. It's gonna take me a little time to get back into the okay. Dragon Ball is back, you know, because it's been gone for a while.
Yeah. You gotta shake off the dust.
Mm-hmm. The proverbial dust that's been. Building for years. But anyway, let's go into One Piece. And in One Piece, we started One Piece at 19 minutes and 19 seconds. I don't want to say I didn't like this episode. I just feel like we got very, 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 very little of Luffy this time.
This was a very slow, like, it's almost the same as Dragon Ball Super in a way that it was a setup episode. And like, unlike Dragon Ball Super, where you were more excited for Dragon Ball Super because it's newer content, One Piece, this was very slow. There wasn't much shown. We didn't get to see much of the Luffy fight. Again, we only saw little flashes of it. And most of what we saw were like civilians trying to escape. And like, that was the majority of the episode. We got some setup with the Blackbeard pirates in the background, which was interesting, but that wasn't enough to warrant an entire episode.
And everybody was running from the birdcage the whole time, and then the head makes I forgot what his name was makes the announcement, keep running, Luffy the straw hatted pirate is fighting Domingo, he's gonna win, just hang in there for another 10 minutes or so tops. I was like, yep. Okay.
So not much happened. So that's pretty much it for One Piece. I'm sure it'll pick up again, but for now it was kind of the calm after the storm.
Yeah, I'm sad though because I was really digging One Piece, and I feel like I kind of got disappointed because I wanted more. I mean,
see, and it's weird because like I feel like One Piece is a much better binge watch, and because from week to week, at least I've noticed now that I've watched from week to week, like 4 weeks in a row, One Piece has really, really slow pacing. Mm-hmm. So I feel like it's better to watch in chunks, but we're going to still watch it weekly. But I feel like once we get to like the Otaku Hour episodes, we'll have a lot more to talk about with One Piece.
Because it'll be four episodes at a time.
Yeah. So I think One Piece will be better for those than for the weekly stuff.
Well, when it comes to any anime, a lot of animes are very good in two episode chunks, because then it's like a 45-minute, like Luck and Logic. When we get to that, I watched the first two episodes back to back.
Yeah,
so did I. I'm sorry, not the first two, the last two. I watched two and three back to back.
Oh, I watched one and two back to back, and then I had to wait for three.
Did I watch one and two back? No, I watched, you're right, one and two back-to-back because of the event that happened at the end of two, which led into certain things in three, right? I watched one and two back-to-back. Three I watched today, so obviously I watched three, duh. Some animes are good to watch in big groups, like One Piece. You watch like four or five episodes, you feel like you got at least something. Other yep. animes, you can watch one episode and you feel like you're satisfied, like Dragon Ball Super or Assassination Classroom.
Assassination Classroom is very good with one and done. So that's why I like it's good to watch week to week.
Even Pokemon and some are one and done. Garo is another one that was very good one and done. But some you have to watch either in pairs or in chunks because it just takes a while for...
Yeah, because, I mean, and that's kind of just the form of storytelling a lot of times with anime in the first place.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, think about X-Men 90s, in the 90s. That show was a to-be-continued fest every week.
Yep, and it was cliffhanger after cliffhanger.
Cliffhanger after cliffhanger. But it was so good when it was done. If you watched it in a marathon, it was so good.
Oh, yeah, it made one hell of a box set.
I gotta get that. Reminded me, I've gotta get that. The 90s of X-Men. But anyway, Fairy Tales. Do you want to talk about that?
All right, so I didn't see episode 93. Again, we're still in the Fairy Tale Zero arc, which is the origin of Fairy Tale itself and their original guildmaster, Mavis Vermillion. And so this is more of Mavis building up her different friendships. She has she makes friends with Hades, who eventually becomes the second guildmaster. His name really isn't Hades, but eventually he becomes a bad guy named Hades. I just don't know how to pronounce his original name to save my life. It starts with a P, and it's really long. It's like multiple syllables, so I'm not even going to try it. So he's just going to be Hades. So it's Hades and Master Makarov's father. Makarov is the current fairy tale guildmaster. And so Makarov's father and the old guy... In current time, he's like an old guy who's a chef, but apparently he was also a part of the original Fairy Tail crew, and he, like, this is their big introduction to Mavis. So this is more Mavis, like, meeting more of her friends, and she's starting to come out of her shell more, that she's, like, you know, learning more about the world, and we get to see more of Mavis herself as a wizard and what she can do. And she's starting to build little bits of a relationship with Xerath. In the background, and if you guys, you know, obviously Xerath is one of the biggest villains of Fairy Tail, so this is kind of his falls to the dark side. Also, the story for him, it's kind of a tragic love story type of thing, and I really like how they're building it up. It's kind of like Anakin and Padme if it was actually interesting.
Nice. I gotta catch up to this series. I feel bad that I was so happy with myself. I'm like, I watched 8 episodes of Pokemon, this, that, and the other thing, and then you're like, oh, Chris, Fairy Tale. I'm like, the one show I said last week I wasn't gonna forget, and this week I forgot it. So I was like, ah, dang it. This week I'm gonna make sure that I catch back up.
Yeah, all you gotta do is watch, I think it's like 90, 91, 92, and 93.
So and then 94.
Yeah.
Okay. That's fair enough. So I guess we'll just jump out into now, Naruto Shippuden episode number, as soon as I put the time in, episode 445. And this again was them chasing after Sasuke. You saw this episode now, Jeremy, right?
Yep.
Okay. This episode, I forgot, what village was destroyed and what relevance did that have to previous stories, because that obviously happened when I wasn't watching Naruto.
Hold on. Crap.
It was the one with the guy that was flying on the animal and he drops a bomb and it destroys an entire town.
Oh, yeah. Deidara destroyed, it wasn't the Sand Village. He did attack the Sand Village. But I know what you're talking about. But yeah, that was Deidara's whole attack in the first place. It was a reference back to that in early Shippuden. So, yeah, it was more of that. It's, again, it's filler, kind of all blends together, so I don't really have much to say on this one.
Yeah, to be honest, it's really pretty much the same. Naruto and the others are still chasing after Sasuke. The leader. You told me the leader's name last time. With the
Shikamaru?
Shikamaru, basically, one by one, he tells teammates to back off, to stay back, and one by one, the people who are chasing them get left back, so it breaks off into several fights, and then it turns out to be just Naruto actually chasing after Sasuke, and Sasuke is super close to the palace or the...
Yeah, Orochimaru's hideout, yep.
Yeah, and that's kind of where they leave you off. I guess the next episode will be the last part to this flashback, and then we'll go into another one.
Yeah, and it's a whole nother series of flashbacks. Mm. Yep, that's just how it is. Naruto is going to be stuck in perpetual filler until they get to animate their children's anime, which I'm excited for, but this needs to hurry up.
Wait, the children are the last arc of the anime, or...?
No, they haven't finished, so that what they what I'm assuming they're going to do, right? Because all they have left to do is literally the final battle between the main bad guy and Naruto and Sasuke.
Okay.
So all they have to... And after that, like, the only remaining material is the future and their kids. So I'm assuming they're waiting for the manga about their kids to be, like, more further fleshed out so they can turn
that. There is ongoing with the children, then.
Yeah, they're going to... It's going to be sometime in spring that they start the ongoing, and it's not going to be, like, a GT-type thing, because the original creator is directly involved. He's not writing or drawing it, but he has the final word on what gets approved and, you know, story-wise and art.
Super. If GT didn't happen and Super took over right after, kind of deal.
Yeah, so that kind of thing. And I'm really excited because, let me tell you, I've watched the Boruto movie like 7 to 10 times already, and it's just, I love it.
Yeah.
Because just growing up Naruto, especially growing up Sasuke, man, I've had a love-hate relationship with Sasuke, but Sasuke is so freaking cool. Oh, man.
I like Sasuke, but I've always been a fan of Naruto, but I guess that's because when I jumped into Shippuden, which it was pretty early on, I believe I bookmarked a bunch on Hulu, and I was watching, like, I think it was 100, episode 100, and I went on from 100. So they were, like, teenagers at the time.
That was the later parts of Naruto, and then when they ended up into Shippuden, where they're, like, 15, 16.
Right, yeah, and they still had, what's his name with them? Not Sasuke. Oh, God, what? K. It starts with a K.
Kakashi.
They were with Kakashi going on missions.
Yep.
So that was my... I started and ended. I think I watched like maybe 20 episodes, and then I fell behind. And I didn't even catch up to the current stuff yet. That's how bad it was. So, that was that.
Now, yeah, so we're going to be stuck in filler for a while. So, excuse the lack of enthusiasm, but it's filler.
Oh, I don't blame you. So, let's go into... All right, hi, everybody. We're back. Apparently, when I mentioned at the beginning of the show I didn't do a test, I really should have, because after this point in the first video we just recorded, from Luck and Logic all the way through to the rest of the video, we crackled, we snap, crackle, popped, we muted, audio disappeared. It was botched up. And instead of doing the whole episode over again, Jeremy and myself, we decided to just start up where we left off.
But a super abridged version. Because there's no way in hell we're going to do all that over again.
Oh, no, because we went on a pretty long tangent with certain things. Not a tangent, but we went on and on about certain things. So we are going to not talk as much. So unfortunately, you guys are going to lose out on a lot of really great stuff we said. I wish there was a way to fix that audio, but there isn't. So I apologize. We did lower the quality now. It should be better. I'm going to be checking this right after we're done recording and praying to God that there's no snap, crackle, or pop, or else we'll probably just end up doing this as a live show tomorrow, which I really don't want to do early tomorrow. So keep your fingers crossed again.
And here we go.
Luck and Logic, you introduced – I'm literally erasing all that we said about Luck and Logic, and unfortunately timestamps are going to stop after Naruto because after the half-hour mark – I the timer says it's a minute right now because we just started again. So I'm sorry for that also. Next episode, I promise things will be better. Luck and Logic, you came to me early on last week and you're like, Chris, you got to check this anime out. And it was Luck and Logic. And I saw the poster, like, you know how on the website
it has the poster.
Yeah.
With the art and stuff, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the poster looked interesting. So I decided to give it a check out, and I'm really glad I did. It was a really good show. It
hooked me right from the opening. Like, the opening theme is what sells me all the time on new animes, and when I heard this opening theme, I'm like, it's a little Sailor Moon-y, but I like it. I liked it.
Exactly, and I was like, okay, I'll try the first episode. And the first thing I noticed, and I mentioned this before, and I'm going to do it again, though, the first episode makes you feel like there was a previous season because they talk about certain events that happen with Yuki, which we're calling him Yuki, by the way, because we cannot pronounce that long name. It made it look like he was a logistic, which are what the heroes are called, and we'll explain what a logistic is in a minute. But it made it look like he was a logistic. He lost his card, which they use cards to trans.
Yeah, it's called a logic card, and it kind of contains the data of their partner on it, and that's how they merge and stuff.
Mm-hmm. And he lost his card, apparently. He had a different suit. He looked more arachne. He was like more of a spider.
Yeah, I'm guessing his previous partner was like maybe a spider god or something.
It all turned out to be a flashback. You mentioned it before, Jeremy, that the opening was spectacular for this episode.
And it's like I really like that it opens up, like you said, how like you think it's like a continuation from something, but it's like the way it opens with that is you get some kind of mystery, like what is this guy's past? Like if he was a logistic before, what made him quit in the first place? You know, that kind of thing. And then you get bits and pieces of his past as we get to episodes 2 and 3. And we even get to learn more about his team that he'll eventually be working with.
Mm-hmm. So it opens up, and it turns out he lost his partner. He lost his car. He's literally just Citizen A. And the sister's happy with this because he apparently almost died the last time.
And his mother, you know, it's not confirmed exactly, but it's heavily implied that his mother died, like, in collateral damage in one of his last battles.
And that his responsibility was to protect his family, which is his father and his younger sister. And Athena shows up with his card. Like, she finds his card. It washes up on shore. She goes to Yuki, and she's like, I found your card. I know all about you because apparently, and you said this before, he made a name for himself. Like he had a reputation.
Yeah, he was, you know, one of the top logistics in the world, And again, we'll explain what the logistics is. That was literally what the bulk of our talk was for Luck and Logic, was explaining the kind of the mechanics of the world. So bear with us. We'll get there.
Yeah, we will. And she gives him the card and she's like, I want to be your trans partner. And he's kind of hesitant at first, but the reason he stopped, or the way it looked in the first episode, was he stopped because he lost his card. So now that he has his card, and the sister is totally against, he's like, no, you can't. You're Citizen A now. You're not them anymore. You're not a hero. You're supposed to protect us. And he's like,
yeah, and you know, she's like, I don't want you to die. I don't want to lose you again. And she kept bringing up, like, what would mom think? Mom wouldn't want you risking yourself like this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he brings up, like, mom would want me to do what's right. And I can't just stand by when I have the actual ability to save these people.
Right, because he didn't have it before. Because apparently there's an attack by, what are they again, Jeremy?
They're called foreigners. Basically, they're demons, kind of alien monsters that breached their current dimension from the god dimension. And so they possess humans to take a physical form, and they are these monsters that attack the cities. Kind of like, if you've seen Evangelion, they're kind of like the angels.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And he trances with this girl, Athena, and he gets a new costume, which I was so happy. It's like a white...
And he's got, like, the owl feathers. It looks more like a bird type of thing. And he has Athena's famous Aegis shield, who, if you're familiar with Greek mythology, that's Athena's famous trademark weapon, the shield that turns people into stone, with the eye of Medusa in the middle. And the shield is really nice. It gave me a real Captain America vibe, which is why I was really liking it.
Me too, exactly. And after that, the government finds out that he's a logistic. He gets enlisted, and it kind of ends with him being introduced to the team, which we do see the team fighting one of the 4.3s.
Each foreigner threat is ranked at a certain level, and I think it's up to 10. Right,
the scale of 10. 10 is the most, strongest, and 0 point something is the weakest.
Mm-hmm.
And we get to see the team at the very beginning a little bit when we get to present day. And
So Yurine is the leader. Mm-hmm. And then there's Amana.
Her trans partner is
Venus. Yep, the Greek gods of love. And then you've got Mana, who is a sniper. She's a long-range specialist. And her goddess is Artemis.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've got Valkyrie. I don't know what the actual girl's name is, but there's Valkyrie. She's like the melee specialist. She uses a sword.
Yeah, she's not really talked about. She wasn't a main character.
I don't think they mentioned her by name either.
I think they did in the first episode, like one.
I've only heard Valkyrie. I don't actually remember hearing her name. But I'm sure she'll get her own episode eventually.
Oh, sure, definitely. So that was the first episode. He gets enlisted, and then he goes in, and the team leader wants to introduce herself and everybody, and he's so tired because he hadn't gotten sleep from the very beginning of the episode. He was up all night rewatching old battles that he had when he was a logistic. Now he's a logistic again.
Yeah, and apparently, you know, back to a little bit of his history, apparently he used to work in Hong Kong, but now he lives in Japan, so he's transferred over to the new branch. And when he gets enlisted, he calls up his old buddies in Hong Kong, and they're like, oh, you're back, that's great, you know, stuff like that. And apparently one of his female co-workers was, like, really in love with him, because she even yells over the phone, like, Yuki, I love you, type. It was funny.
I like Athena's attraction to Yuki also. You could see that she loves him, and throughout the three episodes, there were certain moments where, were you dreaming about me, because
it's really cute. They have these little small moments where, like, they're holding hands or they're hugging, or like she'll ask him for, like, a piggyback ride and stuff. And the thing about the trance system is, right, so basically what the trance system is, guys, is where, like, they have the goddess and you have the, you know, the person who controls the trance, the soldier, and they merge into one person. And, like, they get access to the goddess's powers, but it's also a very intimate experience because you, like, not only do you know, like, not only do you feel the same things as the goddess and as the person, but the goddess will have full access to not only your body, but your mind, all your thoughts, all your dreams, hopes, feels, everything. They'll know every single aspect about you, every ounce of what they like to call your logic, which is why, you know, this is the whole point of the series is, you know, the logic mixed with just a little bit of luck.
And also I love how in episode 2 they really explain a lot of the things they didn't in episode 1 about over-trancing, and if you stay trance too long and it could lead to a poisoning or a sickness.
Yeah, it's a sickness, and then like it could also your goddess could overtake your personality or vice versa. You could overtake the goddess's personality.
It's very dangerous. And I love how Yuki actually is stronger than the leader. Like, he has a faster cooldown time, so to speak, or between.
Because he has a faster, like, recharge time because, like, apparently, like, you can, like, after you trance, there's a certain period where you have to cool off before you can trance again. But when it takes normal people, like, 30 minutes, it takes Yuki, like, 5. Mm-hmm. And it's actually very rare for males to have the ability to trance, which is why most of the members of the team we see on here are females, partnered with other, you know, lady goddesses. Mm-hmm. And so that's really interesting. And I like how they display their relationships. There's a lot of love there. And I'm sure, like, some of them you can tell they're in actual relationships with their goddesses. And then some, they're, like, more big sister type of roles, which is cool. Because you obviously know that Athena has a thing for a Yuki.
She even says it in episode 3 towards the end, "I love you." And I'm like, "Oh."
Yeah, and I like the development. It's just, it's really nice. And it's really sweet. I just really hope that in the end, nobody has to sacrifice for anybody because...
Me too.
I don't know all that.
But in episode 2, the leader has a problem with Yuki because he kind of stood up there.
Yeah, he blew her off. Mm-hmm. It's like she was trying to be nice and welcome him into the team. And he was just like, "Can we kind of skip this? I'm tired. I just want to go to bed." And she's just like, "Oh, so you're just going to ignore me?" Like, I was giving, you know, she wasn't necessarily giving him an order, but she was trying to be nice. And he just said, how she took it was he was basically like, "Screw you, I'm going to sleep."
Exactly. And another thing that happened was in episode 2, they go out in the field because there's a demon that breaks out. We also get introduced to a character called Olga, and we don't know anything about him till towards the end, so I'll leave it till towards the end. And he starts to lead the team because he notices that whatever her name is, because I can't pronounce it. The way she's doing it is she's sending Valkyrie head first into the battle, and he's like, "Why not use..."
Because Valkyrie is like their trump card, their melee specialist. But then, like, he's like, you know, a better strategy would be to use Mana because she's a long range combatant, and it would be a lot easier to take them down from far away if we distract them and she just puts a bullet in his head.
It'll be perfect. And she does. Like, they follow his orders instead, and that's what leads the council to kind of ask the girl to step down. And
yeah, and also the team themselves are really impressed with Yuki. Like, we've never taken down a demon this fast.
Yeah,
or a monster this quick.
No time, exactly. It didn't take so long, and he was an effective person in the field as well as a leader. So he gets promoted to leader, she gets demoted, and that's how episode 2 ends. We also find out that Olga is another logistic. He doesn't have a partner. He has a 0-minute recharge speed, so he can literally trance immediately again. And the reason he doesn't have a partner is he's looking for the perfect partner because he is a perfect logistic.
And he feels like no one else is worthy. He's, you know, even though he is, you know, in theory so powerful, he hasn't had a chance to actually experience any log time. So we haven't actually gotten to see Olga in action. Although he also has this really interesting ability where he can, like, do fortune telling, and he's been able to, like, predict the future. Mm-hmm. So that's cool also. I wonder where that's going to go.
I thought he was going to be a bad guy from the end of the first episode because he's like, chances of you getting hurt really bad, 100%.
Yeah.
I was like, whoa.
And he was like, chances of you overtrancing again is 100%. I'm like, oh, man. So he knows about the overtrance.
And he's saying that he's going to overtrance again at some point. And episode 3 really focused more on Yuki trying to get on the ex-team leader's side or trying to – he wanted to understand why she was so mad. So he goes to the chief and she explains that she was a doctor. You know, she wanted to save
lives. She wanted to be a doctor. And, like, her whole goal was to save people's lives in the first place. And but when she discovered she had these trance abilities, she very much like Yuki. She's like – you know what? If I have the ability to save people, saving lives as a doctor or saving lives as a soldier is pretty much the same thing. So I'm going to do it. But if I'm going to do it, I'm going to do my damnedest to be the best there is, no matter what. You know, and so she always strives to be number one.
Exactly. And when he finds this out, unfortunately, there's a succubus and incubus that threatened, so they go out on the
pill. They're like in the 8-point range, right? Or
I think
close
there was
to 9, I think.
Yeah, and what they did was the chief actually paired Yuki up with the former leader to try to get them to work together and to...
And then we actually get to see the chief in action as well, which
yes,
is pretty freaking awesome.
Because they let the succubus escapes. And everybody's trance time is still going off. Like, they still have to recharge. So Yuki is the only one available to go with the chief. So he goes with the chief. And I question the chief myself. She's a bit shady for my, like...
A little bit, yeah. And also, her goddess is Nemesis. So that's the... And if you know your Greek goddesses, Nemesis is the goddess of revenge. And how her powers work with those bombs, I'm like, dang, that's pretty intense.
And she was just... playing. She wasn't
trying to finish. And she said those were regular attacks because there's like that. Because with logistics, when you're merged, there's a regular attacks, and then there's like your super move, which is what's called your logic drive. Like her Valkyrie, it's when she uses her sword.
I'm glad they didn't show them trancing together. That would be freaky.
Oh yeah.
Now, for those of you that don't know, when they trans, a lot of the girls have a kiss. They are. I think that the website censors it or the TV censors it when you watch it, but there's when the logistics trance with the goddesses, there's an intimate moment, not sexually, but there's a kiss for most of them, except for Venus. They just kind of hug, and that's kind of what happens with Yuki and Athena also, and I think that's why there's a love connection already there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, because they instantly kind of have that bond.
So I'm kind of glad they didn't show Nemesis and Chief.
Because Nemesis looks like a little... Even though Nemesis, because she's a goddess, is probably thousands of years old, Chief is in her like late teens, but Nemesis looks like she's 13. So that would have looked really weird.
Oh, yeah. So I like how Chief kind of pushed whatever her name... What's her name again? Say it again.
Yorine.
She pushed Yorine to actually kill... Like, beyond, because you mentioned that when the foreigners come in, they usually take over a human's body. That's how they survive. And what happened is there was no way to save the human body this time, and Yorine had to kill, and she didn't want to. She never had to and never did, and she didn't want to.
Yeah, because her whole thing is she wants to preserve life as much as possible, not take it.
And Venus even said, you got to do it. You know, this is the moment where if you want to save hundreds of lives, one has to sometimes be sacrificed. And
yeah, and it's kind of that thing where, like, they're in a war, so you don't have the luxury of being able to, like, spare life.
Yeah, and Yuki actually told her, don't do it, because he knew what her personality was. And it showed it towards the end of the episode that she really appreciated that Yuki tried to keep her innocence, even though it didn't work. And then we get to see a monster that was a 10 or 9.8 or 3.
But it turns out it wasn't really a monster. It's actually another goddess, or actually a god, for to be more specific, a god who may or may not be related to Athena, because Athena recognizes this presence instantly and she goes out to meet him. And this god is not a Greek god, but a Christian god or a Christian deity, Lucifer.
And that's where it ends, with Athena going, what are you doing? He's like, I like it here. It's like paradise. I'm going to have fun here.
Because Lucifer tries to trance with a normal person, and that's what sets off the signal. And apparently the regular person couldn't handle it, so he's looking for a vessel. And gee, that who else doesn't have a partner that's a real jackass? Olga?
Maybe, yeah. Olga?
It's not like the new girl is gonna partner with the with Lucifer. I highly doubt it's gonna be the new girl.
No, not at all. I doubt that completely. Or maybe, who knows, it might be a twist of fate. But anyway, that's Luck and Logic. It's a really great anime. I really liked it. I'm glad you introduced us.
Yeah, we'll go into more depth for sure during the Otaku Hour episode. We're both tired here, guys.
We are. We finished recording at 3. It's now 4 because we had to start over again. So you want to go over Gundam Iron-Blooded Orphans episode 16?
All right, so really quick with Iron-Blooded Orphans, what we covered in the first episode was episode 1 with the Gundams rising up from the ground. That was the big cliffhanger. Mm-hmm. So basically, up until this point was that they stave off some attacks, and it's basically your standard Gundam formula: pilots getting accustomed to their machines, bonding with their friends, building up the flight chemistry with their team, and trying to figure out a plan, how to break away from the government that's kind of turned them into this kind of slave labor force, and try to figure out their own way to do things. It's really interesting. Again, I wish I could go into more detail, but I don't want to spoil it for you guys, and I want you guys to check this out for yourselves. But it's one of the best Gundam series that, both Chris and I have agreed, at least in the last decade or so, because we haven't been interested in Gundam in a very long time.
I agree. Now all they got to do is bring Zoids back, and I'll be really happy. I like Zoids. Oh, what can I say?
That would be great.
I forgot to mention one thing. I got to do it again for Luck and Logic. I'm sorry. We have to go back to Luck and Logic. And I mentioned this on the show, and I got to say it here, because if I want you guys to answer in the comments below this question also. Now, my question, I'll post it to Jeremy, because Jeremy's in front of me, but you guys can answer. All right. Trances, right? When it comes to trances, you have to merge with a goddess. Would you be willing to sacrifice everything in your mind, all your deep, dark secrets, desires, everything, all the things that only you know, in order to trance with a goddess, in order to be a superhero?
I mean, like I said before, if this was my only means of... If I had this ability, and this would give me the opportunity to help people, and I knew that I got a chance to know this goddess at least a little bit, mm-hmm. or if this was a goddess I know personally, like I know from legends, because I've studied the mythology, whatever, I would totally be down. Like if it was somebody like Athena or Artemis or Diana, I would be totally up for it. I would definitely, I would take the opportunity for sure. It would be really interesting.
And then when I mention this, and I'll say it again, I feel like, I would worry about the invasiveness, but at the same time, I brought up a story about my ex-girlfriend right before Cindy. She literally, we had been together, we had known each other for a very long time, and she literally got into my head, knew all the things about me anyway. So I feel like you said, if it's a person I've known that really has gotten to know me, that knows what I'm thinking before I even know I'm thinking it, like literally almost could finish my own sentence, I would do it, especially to save the world.
Because this isn't just, it's not like they would abuse this power. Like you know as much about them as they know about you, so they're opening themselves up to you as well. It's not like it's a one-way thing.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So it's a double exposure warning. Yeah.
So it's very interesting, and I wonder if how common it is to develop that love connection that Yuki and Athena have, because I know a couple of them seem like they're in relationships with their girls.
Yeah, I mean, if I had a girlfriend and I had to merge with a different girl,
that would be really awkward.
That would be very awkward. Awkward to go home and say, hey, how'd the merge go?
Also, especially that since you have to live with your trans partner in the barracks all the time.
That would be very hard, yeah. All right, going over that, going back to Gundam now. I agree with you. Gundam has been very... the last thing I really enjoyed was the Shining Gundam one, which I believe was Gundam W.
No, that was G.
That was G. So
because Shining was God Gundam, which is why it's G.
Okay, right. So this one is more. It has a really great story. I can't wait for the orphans to kind of rebel against their master, so to speak, and we get a little bit more of a what's the word I'm looking for here? We get more of them being independent and
I mean, it's not a really. It's not a unique story per se, but it's still really interesting. I mean, it's been done 1,000 times, but I still like it. I mean, have you seen it done with giant robots? I don't think so.
Exactly. All right, so now we're going to go into Garo season 10, season 2, episode 2. I'm putting another, I'm again going to mention the disclaimer here that this is the last time we're going to be doing a previous episode for Garo. Next episode, which will be Anime Weekly episode 3, we will be going into the up-to-date, the current Garo season 2 episode. We will abridge episode 3 to the current point when we get to it. So I enjoyed this episode. Raikou basically, the whole beginning with the darkness guy, it disappears before even the
And then we also find out, we actually get a little bit more background between Raikou and the Empress chick. The sorcerer. We find out like what their connection is and why they're bonded and like what exactly the power of the ring kind of has and what it can do to Raikou if it's left unchecked, which is really intense. Like I said before, it reminded me a lot of Inuyasha when he goes full-fledged demon, and like only Kagome is able to calm him down type of thing, which is why the sorceress girl, who obviously is starting to develop a thing for him, but
she had a thing probably from season not one. She probably had a thing for him since season one.
Yeah, but she pretends to not like him, which is the classic anime trope. But I like it still. It's a cool aspect, and we get into some really dark twists when we find out the origin of Garo's. Why did I say Garo? Raikou's sword. We find out that because the guy's the original owner's son comes after them.
The Watchdogs say that he wants to be their disciple because he's able to become a Makai Knight, and that's kind of what Raikou is. So they kind of get forced because I like the sorceress. She's definitely the comedy relief. She's like, no, I have better things to do with my life. And then they're like, what's your biggest fear? And she's like, butterflies. And all of a sudden, there's like a million butterflies everywhere. And she's like, fine, we'll take him. And then we find out that he's really a
dog. I actually have a friend whose phobia is butterflies.
Really? I don't understand. Butterflies are so beautiful.
Oh, man. No. It was an incident when we were kids. But I'm going to you skip through that. That's a story for another time.
Yes. So they take this guy on, and it turns out long story short, he is a darkness also. And he thinks that Raikou's the one that killed his father because the sword originally belonged to his father. So he has this ability to make the sword choose its owner or choose to kill its owner. And the sword tries to kill Raikou because at first we get a flashback to where the armor kind of took him over for a time. Mm-hmm. So Raikou kind of didn't want to kill the kid at first because he thought that the kid was right because he didn't know what he did. He was kind of like what you said, a berserker, where he had no control. And he was actually saved by the Empress, and she made him her Makai Knight.
Yeah, and there's also this whole thing of, like, you know, whoever kills the previous owner is the one that can control the sword, which is where we get into the dark twist about the sun.
Yeah, so the sword tries to kill Raikou, and he's like, please, I don't, you know, I know that I got you the wrong way, but I want to, you know, repent for all the bad I've done. I want to keep this world safe and protect it. And the sword decides, okay, I want you as my master. And it turns itself over to him. He Makai Knights out. And he fights the kid, and then we find out the biggest twist, and the sorceress knew this all along, the kid actually killed the father and must have blanked it out in his mind and blamed somebody else for it because his mind couldn't deal with the fact.
He couldn't process the fact that he killed his own dad, yeah.
That was a twist I wasn't expecting. This is a very interesting series. It reminds me a lot, like you said, of Inuyasha, and It's really great. The only thing that really bothers me a little bit is the 3D that they throw in out of nowhere.
Yeah, they do use a lot of CGI in this. I didn't expect as much CGI as we've been getting. But also, one thing that I'm very surprised about that I didn't expect is how, like we were talking about, how it swings from dark to funny so quickly.
Yeah, that was weird. It's like one second it's gloomy, death, darkness, whatever, and then it's like this... The sorceress is doing something completely randomly funny, and it's like, wow, that's interesting how it, like...
Yeah, but I feel like it's a good balance, though, which is why I like the show.
Oh, absolutely. I love the show, and I'm looking forward to binging through it. But speaking about binging through, and here we go again. This was one of our longest discussions in the first video. Pokemon XYZ, Episode 2 through 9. Now, I don't have the document open anymore, so I'm swinging this completely by memory. Episode 2, I'm going to give an abbreviated version of everything and then we'll discuss it. Episode 2 is about Squishy, Team Rocket, which in Japan, by the way, Team Rocket's called Gang Rocket. Ash is not called Ash. Greninja is not called Greninja. And Jesse and James have different names as well. A lot of them have more Japanese names. I guess when they translate it to American, they change the names to a more American names.
They get just like in Sailor Moon and not Serena.
There's
instead of Lena, her name is Makoto, stuff like that.
Yeah, I don't like that. I wish they keep real names. But anyway, beside the point, Team Rocket finds out about Squishy, that he's a new type of Pokemon, that if they capture him and they steal him like Pikachu, they'll name him and they'll use him for Gang Rocket. So the whole episode is them stealing Squishy and then Ash getting him back. The next episode, which is episode 3, was them... I'm going to the Pokemon Center to see the professor from the Kalos Islands and to research Squishy to figure out what he is. They figure he's a brand new type or a brand new breed, so they basically have a new species of Pokemon possibly. And then Team Rocket attacks again, so it's kind of a rinse and repeat, but this time they don't want Squishy as much as they want Pikachu and Ash. I'm going to use the American name so you guys don't get mixed up. Meowth isn't even called Meowth in Japan. But we get to see what's the thing again? Not Chansey.
Blitzy.
We get to see the mega evolution of Blitzy. Nurse Joy had a Blitzy, and we get to see it EX evolve, and it was freaking awesome. It beats the crap out of this big Meowth robot thing. I enjoyed it. Ash gets freed, and Team Rocket blasts off again. After that, there were two filler episodes. There was a Litleo episode, which was episode 4. And that was really just focusing around Litleo and its evolution. I believe it's mom or dad, which was a completely...
It's like a Pyroar. Pyroar is the evolved form of Litleo.
Yeah. And it's about Team Rocket stealing it and Pikachu and a few others, a Pokemon. And it was really nice filler, but really it was just about Litleo mostly. The next episode, again, filler, but a lot better. It was about Darkrai. Pikachu and Meowth get trapped in a dream world, so to speak. Like Darkrai traps them in a dream world where Pokemon talk English or Japanese or what, you know, they speak human and humans speak Pokemon. So you got Ash talking like, not Froakie, his evolution, Frogadier. He talks in a Frogadier's voice. Jesse and James talk in their Pokemon's voice. And Meowth and Pikachu, along with actually the other Pokemon that are Serena's, are trapped in this kind of like dream world. And you get to see PanChamp and Chespin go to their third evolution stage. And they look at Pikachu and they're like, this is a dream world. Why don't you evolve? And he's like, Pikachu. Which I thought was hilarious.
Oh, man.
And they break
he
out.
Still, this man still does not want to evolve. Like, they've tried multiple times giving him a Thunderstone.
I think Pikachu is Pikachu, period. That's it. Get a mega evolution for Pikachu, but no Raichu. And they escape the dream world finally. We get to see Darkrai for a bit. Like, everybody sees him and he floats off. Meowth is completely scarred for life. And that was it. The next two episodes, which was 6 and 7, were the ninja village. And the biggest main point to this is there's the regular ninja way. There's another guy who believes a different, more dark way for ninjas to train Pokemon and to show their strength. But the main focal point is Frogadier ends up finally evolving into a Greninja. And apparently Ash and Greninja have this connection. They've had it for since he was Frogadier, where
Since he was a Froakie. He's had them since he was a Froakie.
seriously, so it's since he's a Froakie where they have a bond where anything that happens to Greninja happens to him.
Yeah,
So
I saw that in the earlier episodes of the X and Y series. Yeah, because he found Froakie in the towards the beginning of his journey. So he's had Froakie about pretty much the longest.
out of all of his Pokemon.
Well, out of all the new
Yeah, the
Pokemon.
new one, yeah. So that was the main focal point there. They convinced the bad guy that he's basically doing it the wrong way. He's like, I'm gonna go travel the world and find the right way. So his ideals kind of go back to wanting to be more traditional and do the right thing and be a good guy. So that
Sounds
was
kind of Naruto-y.
exactly. And then the next episode was the least favorite of mine, and this is the one I skipped through the most. They go to I forgot what the name of the town was, Renri Town, where the focal point is Serena and her Pokemon participating in a contest, which is kind of like the video game contest, where they do cooking and then dancing, and then the winner gets the key, which is the award, which is kind of like the Pokemon League badges. And Jessie enters as well, and spoiler alert, she wins. So Serena kind of doesn't win, which was kind of disappointing that we had a whole episode about this and the main character didn't even win. I was kind of
Yep,
like,
and
okay.
but you know the character that we do get is from her Eevee, who starts to come out of her shell,
Yep, she's less shy
and
now.
yep.
I feel like I forgot. Oh, I'll mention it. I forgot. I said it in the beginning at the first time, but I'll say it at the end. So, and then episode 9, which was the most important, I feel, was they make it to the Terminus Cave where Squishy wanted them to go. He goes there. It turns out it's the same cave that we saw from the first episode of XYZ, and he's looking for his brother, I guess, which Team Magma calls Z2. And Team Magma actually makes a reappearance. Team Rocket's going after Ash to get Pikachu and Squishy. Team Magma's going after Squishy, which they call Z1. And it just becomes a three-way fight between Ash, Team Rocket, and Team Magma. And it's just this awesome fight three-way. And Squishy tries to escape from Ash. He wants to be away from them. I guess it's to protect them mostly. But in the end, he does that evolution again where all the littler Squishies combine with him and he becomes that big unstoppable dog, but this time it's in front of everybody.
Yep, it's
And
kind of like a whole unknown transformation, kind of like how in the movies, unknown turned into Entei.
exactly. And he laid waste to Team Magma and he disappeared, and Ash and crew tried to find him and they couldn't. And I like how the little girl said, "You know what? We'll find him eventually, or he'll find us at some point." So that was a really good. I enjoyed. I think episode 9, episode 7, and the Darkrai episode, which I believe was episode
That's
5,
five, yeah.
were the most important out of all of those. That's why I really wanted to just binge watch the whole thing, because I know Pokemon well enough to know that they do a lot of filler before they actually get back to business. And Ash still has two more badges, I believe, to win.
Yep, and that's where the interesting stuff is, where when you actually get into the gym battles, and really, once the league kicks off, is where it gets really, really interesting, usually for Pokemon sagas.
And there was, I think, the second episode, or one of the episodes, there's a Chespin evolution, the second evolution of Chespin, trying to vie for the love of Eevee also. I forgot what episode that was. That might have been during episode 2 or 3. It was like a side thing going on. It was hilarious, but Eevee kind of has a, what do you call it? She's very shy, so she doesn't feel anything for this Pokemon, so he kind of feels heartbroken, so it's kind of sad. I believe that was episode 2, if I'm not mistaken. Want to bring up also, because I want to thank Alan once again. After watching Anime Weekly episode 1, Alan, we were talking about Omega Ruby, me and Jeremy, and Alan messaged me the day after I made the video live. And he's like, "Listen, I have a Charmeleon, I have a Charmander egg. If you want to play Omega Ruby and get to the point where you could trade with people, I'll trade you the egg for it. Just go catch any Pokemon." And I really appreciate it. I figured I'd play the game up until I got Charmander, and then I'd stop for a time. But then I lost my voice and I had nothing to do for the next 3 days. So I literally played through the entire game. I beat all the gyms. I am officially on the road to the Elite 7, the Elite 4. But I beat the 7 gyms to get to the Elite 4. I even beat Groudon. But now that my voice is back, until after tonight, because now I've done a 5-hour show instead of a 2-hour show, I stopped because I ended up starting doing work again. But I really appreciate it. I had a lot of fun. He also helped me evolve my Graveler into a Golem and my Machop into a Machamp. My team is, like, unstoppable. I also like my, oh, God. Starts from C dot, goes to...
Shiftry.
Shiftry, thank you again. I'm not good at the name memorizing thing. I would show pictures. If I could in life hold pictures up of all the things, I would. So and the weird thing was it was so easy to get to that point, though.
Yeah, I feel like the newer games are a lot easier.
Yeah, I think it's to... And then there's also that the experience share. That helps out a lot when you're doing the team thing. We were talking about that for a bit. I guess we'll kind of graze over that this time. That really helps out a lot in the newer Pokemon games. So I'm looking forward to Pokemon Z that comes out in the fall of this year, I believe.
Yep, that's going to be fun.
A lot of fun. All right, so I talked a lot about Pokemon yet again. Any thoughts on Pokemon, Jeremy?
No, I can't wait to catch up because now we're going to get actually into maybe some gym battles, which is always fun.
Mm-hmm. Well, next week we'll have episode 8, so. Yeah.
All right, so are we going to go into Assassination Classroom now?
Or yes, Assassination Classroom.
Okay, so I think we did episode 1. We did episode 1 last time, so now we'll do 2 and 3, which catches us up, like, right on time, right on schedule. And you can do 2, and I'll do 3 with the whole government thing.
Okay, perfect. So 2 and 3 actually go together, so it's kind of ironic. We mentioned this also. Certain animes you could watch in bulk. Oh, I think that part of the first podcast saved. With this, these two episodes, it actually worked perfectly that we watched them side by side. Episode 2, they're back in the classroom now, and I love how one of the – and forget it, I'm not memorizing a million students' names, but she comes up with the idea that Koro-sensei likes pudding. So she invents this big trap where it's a gigantic vanilla pudding, and at the bottom is a bomb. And when he gets to the bottom, they're going to blow the bomb, destroying Koro-sensei.
And it's really funny that, like, his favorite food is pudding, and he's like a gelatinous – squid octopus smiley thing. Face thingy.
Mm-hmm. And I love the whole setting it up, and she's so excited. She's like, she had it planned out good. I mean, they kept any plot hole covered pretty well. And she was ready too.
She's like, this is gonna work, guys. This is it. We finally get to go home. We get our money,
and we're done. And he goes into the pudding. He starts eating it, and then unfortunately, the person who put the bomb at the bottom didn't cover the scent. He found it. He was found out, and what he did was he took all the rest of the pudding and made little pudding cups and gave it to all the students. So even though they failed, they kind of got something in return. So that's why I found it funny, because he's like, literally, oh, you didn't kill me. Here's some pudding.
He's still, like, he is the nicest teacher ever, man. Like, I feel like he would be, like, the best teacher.
I would love to have a teacher like him, I swear. But anyway, then we go into the second part of the episode where he thinks that they should work as a team. So there's a cops and robbers kind of activity.
Yeah, it's like it's almost a training exercise type of thing.
And the geology teacher, he's super good. I mean, he catches them all, but the first time they trick him by giving him a picture of a woman in a bikini, and he like lets them go. He's like, I don't see anything. Go, go, go. And they escape. And then the second time, this girl puts a sob story on him. He's like, I'll let you live. Go, you can escape. And in the end, nobody got caught because they all got free. So that was hilarious. And then...
Yeah, I thought that was pretty funny.
And then we get into the third act, which leads into episode 3 then. Somebody started stealing lingerie. And everybody... And it looks like Koro-sensei. And everybody thinks it's him because he's a pervert. He has all dirty magazines. He has this,
and
that,
he, and he And he has this book. Apparently, he's recording the cup sizes of all his female students.
And I love the one where it says forever flat, and she gets that fire in her eyes, that that evil, like, angry face, forever evil, flat, forever flat. And then another girl's like, I'm a B-cup! I'm a B-cup!
Oh, it's so funny.
But they think it's him, and it turns out the boys on the other side, it turns out he was stealing the girl's lingerie, so he looks like he's dead to right guilty. And it turns out he's like, no, I didn't do it, and the team goes out to try to catch him, and at the same time, he goes out to catch the person that's impersonating him, and it turns out the whole thing is a big trap to catch Koro-sensei, and this guy, Tomar, whatever, it starts with a T, captures him and puts him in this cage that apparently is anti-him, so if he touches the walls, it melts him.
It like burns his skin. It's designed by the government in a way, because they have all these secret projects to kind of destroy Koro-sensei, but none of them have worked so far, but this is one of the more experimental methods. Again, I'll tell you more about Koro-sensei off-camera, because I don't want to spoil anyone here, right. And I don't want any of you guys who've read in the manga to spoil for anyone in the comments as well. No, we'll be watching those.
Yeah, we'll be watching the comments. No spoilers in the comments. So anyway, then one of his previous students comes back, and he has tentacles growing out of his head now, and he's like, now, brother, I'm going to... He calls him brother because they both have tentacles now. I'm going to beat you. And it looks like Koro-sensei is in a lot of trouble. And that's where the episode leaves off, which then goes into episode 3.
Yep, and that's the huge cliffhanger of, like, how do we, like, you know, do we kill Koro-sensei or do we save our friend? And then Koro-sensei, this shows you how great of a character Koro-sensei is, where he's just like, you know what, I don't care. You know what, I'm going to be here for as long as it takes. You guys can kill me at any time, but this is my student. I care about every single one of my kids. We're going to save him. Or you need, and besides, you need every single one of you to kill me if you want to have a chance. So you got to save your friend.
It was funny how the government like thought they had him, and then he's like, you're so sloppy, because the student was he was using the same technique over and over. He's like, I've already figured out your technique. And he actually burrowed out of the trap, mm-hmm. and he got free. I love that.
He is really clever, man. Like, Koro-sensei is always like 15,000 steps ahead.
Mm-hmm.
He's like Octopus Batman.
Exactly, with a big smiley face head.
Oh man, but one thing that like I always say about this show, it balances such serious tones and but really great humor. You know, we went into a whole full discussion about like what the actual context of the show is in terms of Japanese culture, and
it's
crazy
that Japan is really like that.
Yeah, and you know, if we weren't so tired, we'd go in more into it. We'll probably talk about it more in on the Otaku Hour episode.
Long story short, in Japan, your grades determine what classroom you're in, and it also determines your social, your jobs in the future. If you're an F student, you are probably going to be an F job person.
Yep, and then you basically are just considered the worst of the worst. Dirt, scumbag, like, bums. And which is why, like, they feel like Nagisa's class, our main character, the blue-haired guy, who is a guy, I did not know.
Cindy didn't know either, so you're fine.
So apparently his class are all the F students, and the reason why the government turns them into assassins is because since they're the F students, no one would give a crap anyway. Well, society, Japanese society would think nobody would give a crap about them anyway if they were to go on this suicide mission and die, because they're just F students. It's not like they're the A students.
Right, so society won't miss them if they die. So go ahead, finish the episode.
So yeah, it's that whole speech about like, you know, your friend is worth saving, and I'm going to help you no matter what, because I care about all my kids. It's just it's a deep message from Koro-sensei, and it shows how much his character has bonded with these kids over these past two semesters. It's really nice.
They mean the world to him. That's the whole deal. They mean everything to him, and he's willing, even though they want to kill him, he's willing to do whatever it takes to protect them, and that shows that he is such an amazing character. I can't see him die. I don't want to see him die.
It's the ultimate, and I think that's going to be one of the like that's going to be the big ultimate dilemma at the end of the series is like after all this time they've spent with him, are they really going to kill Koro Sensei?
Exactly, and I hope the answer is no. I really hope, because he's got heart. You know, he was framed.
Even if he does have that bomb or whatever that he says he's gonna blow up if they can't kill him before the end of the full school year.
Right. So they've got two more seasons to go, I think.
Yep. It's gonna be really interesting.
He's not gonna blow anything up, I don't think. That's my opinion.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see how things go.
So it ends with them basically getting the kid. You know, they try to save him. They try to fix the tentacle problem, which they do in the end, and they he becomes a student of the teachers again, of the Koro Sensei's school. And I love the joke about the ramen, though. That still makes me laugh.
Yeah, that's hilarious.
He's like, I'm poor, so I'll eat your.
So I'm gonna have to eat. I'm gonna have to eat your crappy ramen that makes me keep puke. And he gets so pissed off.
He's like, oh.
Because he takes such pride in his cooking for some reason.
He needs a lot more work.
Oh, man, it's funny.
All right, do you want to do the Dimension W overview really quick, and then we'll wrap up?
Okay, so really quick, Dimension W is kind of like this sci-fi Blade Runner type series where they gain access to this extra-dimensional plane called Dimension W where they can tap into like an unlimited energy source, and they turn it into this thing called coils, which is, you know, it's almost currency. It's this type of technology that stores this unlimited energy. And obviously this energy source is a huge commodity, which leads to a lot of illegal production of coils. The main character becomes this police officer who's in charge of tracking down these illegal black market coils. And he ends up running into this girl. We find out this girl has an ability to detect coils. And so she talks her way out of getting arrested into instead of getting arrested, to working with this guy instead, our main character, and she ends up teaming up with him, and now they're, you know, tracking down coils, busting down, like, these, you know, trafficking rings and all this other cool stuff. It's really cool. It's a nice sci-fi series. Like I said, this season has been really good for sci-fi with Luck and Logic, Gundam, Iron-Blooded Orphans, and, like, even to an extent, I would say Garo, even though Garo's more fantasy.
I don't know what my phone just did, but I'm scared. My phone just made like a noise. I'm like, possessed. It's possessed.
But yeah, that's pretty much Dimension W. I skipped over a lot of details, but I definitely highly suggest check it out. It's only 3 episodes in.
I'm excited, and we are definitely going to go from episode 1 through 4 next week. And with that, that's the end of all the episodes. Now, next week, reminder again, Garo, we will be doing the current episode. We will catch up with all the episodes of Dimension W, so it'll be 1 through 4. I think all the other series we are now officially on schedule with.
Oh yeah, and we're skipping. We're gonna go up to current for Gundam as well.
Yes. Well, we are up to current now. Episode 16. You did today.
Yeah. We did. We just did. I covered up to 14. I didn't get to 16 yet.
Oh, okay. So that was still episode 14. So again, I will correct it to episode 14. Next week, we'll be up to date with Gundam as well. Jumping around, we don't recommend. If you want to get into an anime, you start from the very beginning. But for the sake of this is a current anime show, we are going to jump to current anime episodes. Because cramming 9 episodes of one show into a day hurts.
And besides, Wiki can help. Wiki is your best friend.
Yes, sir, it is. So... Uh-huh. Again, I'm saying, hope you guys enjoyed this episode. I'm really happy you guys enjoyed the first episode, the messages and everything. It was really nice. I'm glad you guys like it and you want us to continue it. We are definitely going to be continuing this. I'm just really glad for all the positive feedback I got on this.
Yep. And be sure to check out, if you enjoyed, you know, our week-to-week stuff, definitely be sure to go over to Frontline on Sunday to check out our first episode of the Otaku Hour, which is going to be our like more condensed and in-depth version of this, where we talk about all the anime for this month, as well as do a little Q&A with you guys, maybe do a viewer suggestion, you know, for the following month and stuff like that.
And also, we will be previewing stuff that you guys will be hearing on Anime Weekly Episode 3, which we will be recording that night, which you won't see till Monday morning. This was late because the pay-per-view was yesterday, so unfortunately we weren't able to record last night because I was watching the pay-per-view. So maybe next time I'll work it out to, after the pay-per-view, we'll do Anime Weekly. We'll see. But now that we're caught up, it's literally just 10 animes a week instead of 200 animes in one day because of all the episodes. As always, the comments below, let us know what you guys thought of any of the shows that we talked about here. Recommendations, your thoughts on characters, anime in general. We love hearing from you guys. No spoilers for anything that's, you know, manga ahead of anime, like Assassination Classroom. Also, while you're down there, in the description below is a link to Jeremy's channel, to other stuff right here on Dark Avenger C86, Comic Frontline, Zone 4 Podcast, Frontline Gaming Zone, and Last Ember Present. Speaking of Zone 4, it was officially, it's official as of sometime this past weekend. Anime Weekly is officially part of the Zone 4 Podcast Network.
Yeah. Woo!
So we are officially a part of the awesome shows that are compiled on Zone4Podcast.com. And even better news, when I do start on SoundCloud, when I do start working on iTunes, there will be an audio version of Anime Weekly, and we will maybe put in some extras at the beginning or end. Maybe. We'll see. I'll let you guys know. But obviously, if you're going to go listen to this on SoundCloud, we're going to want to give you something extra. So we'll see what we might spice up in the extras column. We'll see.
Yeah, we'll figure out some extra content that'll be SoundCloud exclusive. That's, that should be fun for you guys.
Oh, yeah. And we might have SoundCloud exclusive episodes as well. Again, this is all tentative stuff. I have not started SoundCloud yet. So, but when it does happen, this show, along with all the other shows on this channel, will be a part of the SoundCloud account and on iTunes, so you guys will be able to hear us on iTunes. And, of course, as always, still part of the Zone 4 Podcast Network, which is awesome. So, yeah, links, comments. Hope you guys enjoyed this episode. Hopefully we will not have the same quality problem next week. I'm still working on this program and praying to God when I hit the stop button that everything works. So until next week, everybody, watch your favorite anime, enjoy some Japanese cartoons, and until then, take care, keep reading, keep collecting.
Stay virus-free, guys.
Take care, everybody.